everybody. I'm here today to speak about Atomic, as Garrett has said, spoiling half of my talk. Justin said, I'm working at Red Hat. I'm currently a sysadmin in the community team. So I'm managing community community system like gluster.org and everything. And before that, in my previous life, I was a packager, sysadmin, build system maintainer for Magia for a few years. And before, I was a Python coder for a firewall startup. I will explain later why it matters. And before, I was again a sysadmin in some unnamed European institution, especially because we were playing Counter-Strike. And so if we want to explore a new way, it's nice to start by, the old way of managing a system. I guess everybody will find that obvious. Currently, you take a Linux system and you take some piece of Lego and assemble some set of package. So either a binary package, like RPM, Debian, or whatever you want. Or you can use a source package, which is a Gen2 or a derivative. If you want to get the best of both worlds, or the worst of both worlds, you can have both ways, which is mixing a source compiled package with binary package and everything. That's, for example, what is done partially by some BSD, depending on what the admin wants, using a base system, which is compiled, and sometimes a binary and port can be compiled or binary. So that's one side of the spectrum. And the other side is basically the appliance, what you can find in a firewall, or what you can find in your phone on a tablet. And today I'm trying to speak about new way, which is basically what is Project Atomic about. It was the first project I was working on 6-9 months ago. And it was not clear at first what was it. The only thing that was clear was that we had 2 weeks to set up everything due to some deadline, so we managed to do that. And basically, that's a code name for a set of distribution. We have some principles that I will explain later. And based on that, we adapted some Red Hat sponsor distribution. So that's mostly CentOS and Fedora. And I'm not here to speak about a corporate product. While we would love to have other people join us, no one did. So yeah, the project is named not because we suddenly decided to pay a tribute to Oppenheimer or something else, but because of the concept of atomic upgrade, which I will explain later. It's mostly also around container, Docker, and everything. On the website, we say that this is a lightweight, but since we have a pressure from everybody to add something, I think in 6 months I will just remove it from the website, because everybody is okay to have something lightweight, but with their specific version of lightweight. And this is the basis of OpenShift V3, which is a platform as a services, but yeah, that's basically what Garrett already explained, so let's get a bit more technical. I didn't find a good way to explain, so I will just go component, bottom to top. So the first component we decided to use was ostree. Ostree was a project which is, I think, 4 or 5 years old. It was created for testing GNOME. And the idea is, right now, you have your laptop, your server, your workstation, your phone. You decide to start it, and it will load the file system, and from the file system, start services or whatever. And when you want to upgrade, you upgrade a set of packages, as I said before. With ostree, you decide to boot on an image, and the image cannot be changed. That's basically a bootable read-only file system. Since we still need to do some stuff like write a log configuration, everything is done in slash /usr. There is some, hack to link etc to slash var and everything. So slash var can be changed. And slash user is the actual image that cannot be changed. You want to get a new version meaning an updated bash because you want to be protected from shell shock or an actual big upgrade. Well, you have to reboot on a new version, which can be seen as annoying, but you also can reboot on an old version, which make rollbacks possible. I do not know if people are following this topic, but for example, with RPM, this is quite hard to do because you have a script that can modify the system and everything, and the script cannot be rolled back because if you add a user, you cannot remove it without having side effect and everything. So by using this approach, you can have a purely atomic upgrade. Either it upgrade or it don't. And if it don't, you can go back and use the previous one that was working, of course, provided that you didn't remove, that there is no hardware problem and everything. And yeah, the developer calls that Git for file system, because you can have a multiple branch, you can, well, you cannot make diff, but it's quite efficient. You do not have to store a complete image each time. I mean, it's nice to fill a hard drive, but it's better if you don't. So that's for the basis of the system, why it's called Project Atomic. But an operating system that you cannot modify is not that interesting, especially for a customer and user. For a sysadmin, it's quite great because the less user can do, the less they can break. Perfect. But yeah. So on top of that, we decided to add Docker and systemd. So Docker mostly to ship application with runtime. Because again, if we want to have a minimal system, well, we are not gonna ship Ruby and Python and Scala and Java and PHP and Node and everything. So every application comes with a runtime thanks to Docker. And as we also follow the API infrastructure pattern as explained by Garrett, we use a systemd to have an API to start, to monitor, to control the services. Since services tend to use resources, and while we want to limit them, we are also using cgroup to limit the container. So you can say this web application can only use 1 gigabyte, this Java application can use 20, and this kind of stuff. But that's still by too low level. So Red Hat decided to create a project called GearD to be dropped 2 months later once Google announced Kubernetes. And merge GearD in Kubernetes. But since everything is not done, while there is still some part of GearD on the system. But last time I did this presentation, they changed just in the morning, they announced that GearD was deprecated. So I will not speak too much about that, because there is likely a commit that changed everything between the time I started and the time I finished the presentation. So the goal is to orchestrate a container, because with Docker and systemd, you can say start one, start two, and everything. But right there, we want to say start these services, like HTTPD must be started on 3 containers, because we want to make sure that 2 of them are working if 1 of them is failing and everything. It manages the network, which is still a complicated task. It distributes the task, make sure that everything is running on different containers, again, because a computer can fail, and the more you have, the more they fail. So yeah, answering redundancy and various other things, like making sure that your SSH keys are in the container and everything, streaming the log, etc., etc. As I said, this is used for OpenShift, and OpenShift is a platform as a service. Which means that basically the whole internet can send whatever they think that should be running on the platform as a services. And yeah, we do not trust people, mostly because we have seen people trying really crazy stuff, running Bitcoin miners, trying to spam people using the free resources of the platform as a services. And yeah, the fact that people from OpenShift team posted something like running Minecraft on OpenShift likely didn't help, but yeah. So we wanted to have isolation. So there is basically two types. We want to protect the bus system from containers, which is if you are root in the container, doesn't mean that you are root outside of the container, except if there is kernel exploit, and even for that, we want to mitigate that. And we want to protect container from a container, because the whole idea is that everybody is sharing a host, but that doesn't mean that you have to trust some random person on the internet to not attack your website. Well, if I do not know if people know how SE Linux works, but everything is running on a specific security domain. And so this is splitting future the security domain between the container. And since we wanted to have something to present, because for now it's mostly a server and a boring text interface, we added a web interface called the cockpit, which is usually the only screenshot I place in my presentation, but I did not have time, so we'll just skip this part. But it's just to say that you can have a nice, shiny UI. So yeah, the question is, why did we do that? It's not like we designed everything. It's mostly because we have seen light and we decided to enter. So as I said, for example, ostree come from a GNOME QA. It was used since 5 years. The idea was you compile the latest Git version of GNOME, you test it, you report bug, and you want to test regression, you can boot on a previous version. And since this is an image, well, you can make sure that you test the same image across across every tester, which is like maybe 3 or 4 people in the world, because no one is doing QA in the open source world, except being paid for. The same goes for Docker. Well, this is not a new idea, this comes from jails, which likely come from IBM technology from the 70s. This gave OpenVZ and Linux namespace, which created Elixir and Docker. So it's something going on since years. Well, SE Linux, this is using SVIRT. It's a technology that we use first to protect virtual machine from each other. Again, nothing new. And yeah, systemd was created mostly to make sure that people are discussing on the internet, not for Project Atomic. So yeah, all the technology have been well created from something else, and we just say, yeah, maybe this is ID, could we use this part, this part, this part. And the real reason why we did that, as far as I know, it's well, pressure on IT department, who are part of the customer of Red Hat. So there is pressure to automate more, not because this is making the life of sysadmin easier, it's mostly to drive human cost down. I mean, if you can manage more servers with less people, it's better. There is also pressure to collocate service more. So again, this is to drive hardware spending. And of course, with less resource, we want to deliver faster, because this makes more profit. And there is the whole idea about agility and DevOps, which, as far as I know, can be, well, it's not only that, but it's mostly this kind of problem, like the developer system who are running the latest Fedora version, which is different from the prod server, which is running a Well 5. It's something that happened at my previous startup, and everybody was wondering who was testing, because we were all running the latest Debian, and it turned out that no one was doing that. So, of course, for Python software, it caused some problem in production and everything, but yeah. So that's quite dry, and I want to explain more how this can be applied to a regular infrastructure. So I will not do a hello world like here is a static web page and here is something, and now you can scale your hello world to 20,000 machines. I will speak about gluster.org web infrastructure. So we decided, I think 3 weeks ago, that well, something needs to be done for it, mostly because it's currently services installed off top of the old services and everything. So we want to restart from scratch. And there was a meeting for starting a proposal that will be discussed later with community, and we started with a static website because it's much easier to scale and much easier to manage, and You do not have to wake up the admin at 3 o'clock in the morning to update WordPress because there is a security problem. And being the admin, I appreciate that. So of course, that means that you need an HTTP server. Static website needs a builder, something that convert what web designer produce to something that the browser can understand, if possible, with a markup, CSS, and everything, because we could just give text file, but it's not going to work. For the community, we still decided to have a wiki, and we decided on MediaWiki. In turn, this means a database. And to protect from a slash dot effect, Varnish caching server. And of course, since we want to see how much Twitter is working when we are posting blog posts and everything, we want to have some statistics. So we decided, well, we will propose an AWS stat. So a traditional way for doing that, which is basically what I would do if it was my own system, is everything on one server. Because this is cheaper, and I cannot pay the Oyster card and a server, so since I'm here, I only have one server. If I had more resources, I would likely do using a virtual machine, and yeah, basically one virtual machine per services. And since I'm not here to talk about the old way, I will just propose to use a container, and that's basically everything in different container. I will not call that microservices, because for me, microservices implies that you have some API and different people to manage everything, and in this case, it will be me. So I will decide with myself about the API I will be using, and this kind of stuff is not really that. And yeah, so the question is why? It's not only to show that for the presentation, it's mostly that, but not only that. Because well, as a current approach, we have a few problems. So I said that there is a website. So static website, quite easy, you just need some builder. The web designer decided to use a middleman. So I do not know if you know, but this is Ruby. And well, I decided to make no comment on the stability of the platform. And yeah, our web designer also use Fedora 20. He upgraded to Fedora 21 last week, so yeah. And we already have enough problem when we build on Fedora 20 because, well, sometimes it's different or it's not exactly the same, so we use that for the builder, but as much as I like Fedora, I would prefer to not have to upgrade so often. So, for now, we have a separate system, which is just reading everything. Of course, I'm the only one to have access. So when there is a problem, like trading problem, a global variable problem, I have to spend one full day with the designer to fix it. It happened last week. So yeah, that's a problem that we have. And if we had the same exact version on his laptop and on the server used to build, well, it would help a lot. So using containers, that's something we can achieve. Another problem is unpackaged software. And I do not want to single PHP, but I will. In this case, this is a MediaWiki. It's not a problem to not be packaged. The problem is to not be maintained by anyone but me. So that means that I have to make sure that everything is up to date, upgrade it. Again, I said that I didn't want to single PHP, but experience shows that there is more than often a security problem. So having worked in the security industry, I'm still paranoid. I'm taking some time, some pills for that, but I still want to make sure that MediaWiki is properly isolated, ideally like completely cut off the network, except to speak to Varnish. So I can be sure that no spam is sent and nothing happened. And the problem with MediaWiki is that, well, it's not a problem, it's a feature. The problem is when people use the feature. The feature is that you can extend it as much as you like, and the problem is people extend it, and there is sometimes some nice extension, and people use it, use them, and then they are stopped to be maintained, and since I do not spend my time watching the extension, I do not know. And suddenly you upgrade and it's broken. And of course, it's a critical business extension, so I have to fix it, which means doing PHP or revert on everything. So being able to test upgrade and rollback and everything would, well, be really great. So again, with a container, I can test upgrade, and if I'm not happy with the upgrade because the extension that transforms Pony on Pony moving GIF or something like this is broken, I can just roll back and find someone to fix the problem for me. There is also scaling issue. So not for, it's not a real problem because we have big enough server, but we are using MediaWiki for another project. And it's taking more than 1 gigabyte of RAM when there is more than 10 or 20 people looking into the wiki. So it gets killed by the platform, which of course puzzled everybody until the sysadmin said, oh, you know that your MediaWiki is killed because it's using too much memory. Well, of course, we didn't know. We do not have access to the log. So we wanted to make sure that everything can scale. The problem is that MediaWiki is writing on the file system, and it's not going to work that much. So we can use S3 back storage, which means that we need to add a Swift container. And the last problem that we want is if we want a new version of something, let's say that Varnish 4.0 is out and we want to use it. It's not a good example because it's out and it's already in Well 7, but let's pretend that it was last year and Varnish 4.0 was out and Well 7 was not out. So if we wanted to have a new version of something, we would need to have, for example, a Fedora container. So yeah, that's the kind of stuff that we want to achieve with using a container, like upgrading everything separately, making sure that everything can scale. If suddenly we need a second Varnish, we can create a VM and add it to the cluster. It also brings a few constraints. So treat container as a kettle. If you decide to kill them, they should be stateless, which is easy for Varnish. It's easy for the static website. It's less easy for MediaWiki. Ideally, you have a throwaway instance, as I said. There is the issue of intra-container communication. If we want to have MediaWiki speak to Varnish and to MySQL, we need to have something for that. If I had more time, I would explain the data container pattern, which is basically of a container which is only here to hold the data, and the container will be shared with every other container. That's something supported by Docker and Kubernetes. I would suggest to look that, because that's how people are doing a lot of stuff. Ideally, you should follow the immutable infrastructure pattern, which means that no one should connect to the container and change it by hand. That's a problem we had in my previous startup. Customer reported bug. It was urgent, they had to fix it. So we connected on the firewall, fixed it, and said a note, we'll fix later, with later never coming. So every customer had a different firewall, which of course was great for debugging later and great for making sure that nothing breaks and everything. Ideally, you must take scalability in account. I guess it goes without saying that this is complex to do. You can use Kubernetes and etcd for that. Etcd has a distributed k-value and everything. Kubernetes making sure that everything scales when you need and everything. The real big problem would be on the application side. For example, MySQL replication, Swift replication. So if I manage to convince the community that this is a good approach, I think it's maybe too complicated, but I need to have some working example. Well, we'll need to follow a development workflow. So that's quite easy. You install a few atomic hosts. That's easy. You decide that everything is client, one is master. Everything can be done from the host. It depends on the service running. The service running is a specific configuration, so it's not part of the atomic upgrade. And then you need a custom container. So containers are not coming from the sky, falling from above. You need to have some place to store them, which is a role of a registry. So it's usually better to have your own registry rather than pushing everything to the public, because you can be sure that if it's working, it's because you make it working. You do not depend on whatever services you are using. So either you use a Docker registry, which is a ship with Docker, and running in a container, or you can use some product that I decided to just show right now, which is Pulp, with a specific plugin. So everything can be run in a container, so you can run your container in your container and manage everything. Then once you have set up everything, you can just upload the definition to Kubernetes. It's quite easy, unless they change again the syntax. You just create a JSON file to describe everything. So if I had time, I would have shown you, but I decided that this will be left as an exercise, and it would have been too big for the screen. You need also to, then you need to decide, well, ideally you need to decide before uploading the definition to Kubernetes, how you build the container. I do not think there is a 1 million approach. The one we use internally in Red Hat is a layered container, which is basically you select a base, which for our corporate reason will be Well 6 or Well 7. Then you decide to add a runtime, could be Ruby, could be Java, could be anything. And then you start to add your custom code. For example, well, it's not your custom code if you are uploading MediaWiki, but this is a custom code. We have a tool for that called Source to Image. You give a Git repository and it will merge that with whatever container you want. Again, this is used for OpenShift. I think it's nice for your custom code, but maybe not adapted for custom code of someone else. And yeah, you need to decide how do you update. So you need to make sure that there is a testing, QA, maybe setting a different server, being able to tag everything. So yeah, that's basically the basis of how we could operate. There is still a lot of questions open, which is nice because I only have 3 minutes left. So there is the question of configuration management. How do you configure everything? Because before it was describing your infrastructure. Right now you have to describe the infrastructure and create some specific artifact, which will be a Docker container that will be deployed and everything. It's more orchestration than configuration management. There is a question of backup. For example, the MySQL database, how do you make sure that there is backup? Like if someone decides to upgrade and break everything or this kind of stuff. There is, of course, the question of monitoring, which requires some specific adaptation, because you can, of course, see if the web server is answering and everything, but you want to get more than that. Log centralization, this is, I think, a solved problem, but you need to configure everything for that. Since the container can be anywhere on the cluster, you want to make sure that they all send the log at the same place, especially if you want to do something with a statistic. Something which is not a solved problem is how do you decide who is able to upgrade what container. For example, I would be able to delegate the upgrade of the MediaWiki container to someone that cares about the wiki, while I do not want them to upgrade the Varnish container, or I do not want to give root to everybody that decides to help me. There is the question of network management, which seems to not be a solved problem on Docker side. They are still discussing about various API and everything. There is some project like FleetD or Flannel, or some people trying to create a UDP tunnel between the container and the overlay over OpenStack, and lots of very complicated stuff just to make two processes communicate. I'm pretty sure that there is a lot of stuff, so I will just let you see the website and appreciate that it's working after I installed an HTTPD server.